Hi everyone, and welcome to our IAT210 Let's Play analysis of FIFA 18. The FIFA series is one which has been produced by Burnaby's own EA Sports since 1993, and since its inception has become one of the video game industry's best-selling franchises. FIFA is a game with many game modes, as can be seen in our scrolling through the main menu of the game. At the heart of its many modes, however, is its game simulation. To demonstrate this game mode, we will show gameplay of this simulator while we describe FIFA in more detail. When we played this game, we did so using a PlayStation 4 console and its DualShock 4 controllers, though it's important to note that the game is also available on PC and Xbox, along with a mobile version. In its most basic form, FIFA is a game which, if examined through Kaiwa's modes of play, can be defined as a mimicry game for its offering of role-playing and simulation. At very least, players let the game's engine simulate entire games which they may view, and at most, they can control entire teams' on and off-field moves in Career Mode and Ultimate Team, role-playing as a manager or a player. If examining FIFA through Lindsey Grace's paradigms, it would likely be considered a simulation game above all, although the argument could absolutely be made for there being strong action and RPG immersion elements in the game that attract players. When speaking on the rules of FIFA, it would be wise to look at Parlyte's rules and how they apply to it. First, you have behavioral rules. These have to do with the fair treatment of others and being a good sport. When it comes to FIFA, this more has to do with not knocking the controller out of your hand, or, in the case of something like a penalty shootout, when a player is choosing which way to shoot, not looking to see which way they're going to go before the shot comes in. The second subset of rule has to do with written rules. These, luckily for soccer fans, are quite easy to prescribe to, but for those who do not, there are tutorials within the game that help with this. Some examples of this should be that if the ball goes out of play, there is a throw-in awarded along the touchline, and a goal is awarded when the entirety of the ball crosses the goal line. Finally, there's advisory rules. These are more unwritten and really have to do with strategy in FIFA. One example of this would be that it is best to have a formation played with three or more defenders for a player, and with an equal balance of attacking and defensive players. In regards to required skills of FIFA, physically, there are not many. Really, all you need is coordination and knowing how to navigate the remote control. However, when it comes to the mental aspect of it, decision making and knowledge of the rules of soccer definitely help players in some cases.
FIFA is a game which is played on a continuous three-dimensional space. When it comes to attributes, every player is given specific attributes around their speed, dribbling ability, and other factors, including their mentality. Most of these attributes would, technically speaking, be considered static attributes because they won't change. However, EA Sports has downloadable content which can change these throughout the game, and obviously, because the game is so dynamic, these can change and be dynamic throughout the game. FIFA also demonstrates many of Garneau's 14 forms of fun, including beauty, competition, social interaction, power, and creation. As well, FIFA is a game which, because of its diverse and wide range of game modes and challenges, offers all four aspects of interactivity: cognitive, functional, explicit, and meta. It would perhaps then be beneficial to more explicitly outline which game modes in FIFA hit on certain gamer motivation model elements. In kickoff mode and any mode which involves online play against opponents, gamers are typically motivated by the social element of the game, as it provides a perfect platform for competition. In the game's Pro Clubs mode, players can create their own individual player, which can, by the way, be done in some other game modes, and can team up with friends or strangers from around the world. This game mode is exemplary of FIFA's high level of creative freedom, and we will show just how interesting and fun it is to create a player in FIFA near the end of this video. In modes like the game's Career mode, players are more likely to be motivated by the immersion and mastery aspects of the game. In Career mode, players are given high agency in more aspects of their success than simply gameplay. In fact, they take control and commandeer a team's financial issues and/or player transactions, in addition to controlling the team's not only tactical choices, but, if they so desire, in-game play.
What we're seeing on the screen right now is me scrolling through job offers on FIFA Career Mode. Next, I'm going to go into my finances section, where you can see all of the different financial elements that are going into the success of my club. Obviously, different details like this give the player a high level of player agency, which, in many cases, attracts them to the game and gets them more invested.
Another popular gameplay mode is that of the Journey, in which players role-play as fictional player Alex Hunter. In this game mode, players not only engage in gameplay, but but are tasked with making conversational decisions which impact how they are perceived by fans and their manager in a ludological story mode. Thus, this game mode is popular with those who play for immersion. Elements of social competition, immersion, and mastery are all present in FIFA's most popular game mode, Ultimate Team. Introduced in EA's 2009 version of the game, Ultimate Team provides the premise of creating your own dream team by opening packs of, trading for, and winning virtual cards representing real-life players. Interestingly, Ultimate Team's design is set up on a freemium model, typically seen in mobile games. That is to say that players may play the game for free, but also have the ability to pay real-world money for advantages in the forms of packs of cards. One of FIFA's main cultural strengths is that it has a great deal of multi-interactivity embedded in the game. Not only are there world championships every year to crown the world's best player, and an exceptionally large streaming and YouTube community revolving around the game, but EA Sports designed the game to also be able to reflect real-world soccer. When players go in to play a quick match against their friends, which we've seen before, they have the option of choosing to download and play with real-life form, meaning that teams and players who are playing very well in real life will have their stats boosted accordingly, and those doing poorly, vice versa. This creates meta-interactivity far beyond the average sports game. Some real-life soccer teams, including the Vancouver Whitecaps, have actually founded esports teams for FIFA, showing just how powerful the participatory culture for the game is. Development-wise, large developers like EA typically develop games using the agile production method and a direct-to-retailer distribution model, in which they publish the game before distributing it to retailers who then sell directly to consumers. In this model, the revenue generated by the game would typically mostly come from its original purchase price. However, with Ultimate Team's freemium model, EA in fact makes more money off of additional purchases in that game mode than through selling physical copies of the game. As a franchise, FIFA also makes a killing due to its yearly release schedule. Whereas most games take years upon years to develop new animations, storylines, and gameplay, FIFA releases a new game every calendar year, and thus, while there are small improvements made every year, the differences between yearly versions tends to be nominal. Yet you can bet your bottom dollar that dedicated fans will still shell out $80 for the newest version come every October. In regards to who exactly is shelling out that $80, we must note that, being a soccer game, and soccer being the world's most popular sport, FIFA players come from all walks of life, social classes, and genders. However, the average fan of FIFA the video game, if one were to do a persona presentation, would be that of a 12 to 30-year-old male, who is in some way a sports fan. Unfortunately, the participatory culture surrounding FIFA is very male-dominated. However, as of last year's game, EA have actually included women's teams in an attempt to promote diversity and women's soccer in general. It was definitely a big step forward for sports games as a genre, as no other sort of sports game allows players to play as real-life women's teams. Despite its resounding success, FIFA is not the only major player in the soccer video game market. Pro Evolution Soccer, made by the Japanese developers Konami, is also very popular. However, FIFA maintains a stronghold over the market because of not only the massive participatory culture it has established around the game, but the fact that EA also pay extra in order to officially license numerous leagues and teams around the world every year, whereas Konami do not. Players then, looking for the most realistic game possible, will naturally gravitate towards EA's FIFA series, as it provides the closest thing to real-life soccer. After all, if you want to play with your favorite teams, it's nice to see their official badges and stadiums, as opposed to generic representations. In other words, Manchester United is a lot more fun to play with than Manchester Red. We've now come to the end of our video. Thank you sincerely for sticking with us through our narration of sometimes dull but nonetheless very important information about the game of FIFA. If you can, we very much recommend that you at least try out FIFA. There's so many game modes that you're bound to find your niche somewhere, whether it's in career mode, ultimate team, the journey, pro clubs, even just playing kickoff mode against your roommates. It's a lot of fun, and there's so many different game modes that you're bound to find something that you'll enjoy. All in all, thank you for kicking it with us, pun intended, and have a good one.